when we studied first law of motion, it was all about the fact, it was mainly discussing the fact that to change the state of rest, to change the state of motion, or to change the direction of motion, you need to have some external force. Otherwise, if there is no external unbalanced force acting on the system will not change. It means it will not change its state of rest or motion or of uniform motion or direction. Fine. So second law basically deals with how much force. Okay, so first law gave us an idea that yes, we need a force to bring about any change in the state of rest or motion of an object. And the second law gives us a knowledge of how can we measure force. And in fact, if you go to higher levels, you get to know that it is actually the second law of motion, which is the real law of motion, in the sense that using second law of motion, you can explain the first law of motion and the third law of motion. Okay, so today, before we start our discussion on second law of motion, we need to know about a physical quantity called as momentum. Now, momentum, why was the need felt for this physical quantity? So what scientists argued were, they argued that when the force is acting on a body, what are the factors do you think which affect force? Which factor do you, in your opinion, I'm asking for your opinion, which factor affects force as per your understanding of force?
Mass and velocity.
Okay, can you elaborate on that? How mass affects or how velocity affects? Okay, basically, what happens is this. You must have seen this in, observed this in day-to-day life, that suppose there is a car traveling at, say, a speed of 30 kilometer per hour or 20 kilometer per hour, and a truck traveling at the same speed. If they go and hit a stationary object, say a cycle, which one of them will cause more damage? Both were moving at the same speed. So which of them is bound to cause
more? I'm cycle because it has less mass.
Array, I said there is a cycle. First a car hits it and then a truck hits it. In which case will the cycle get damaged more?
Ma'am, the truck one.
Obviously, in the case of the truck, so both were moving with the same speed. Okay, I gave same speed to both, but still a truck causes considerably more damage as compared to the car. So they argued that yes, mass is one of the factors that affects ki how much force is going to act on the object. Satisfied with this explanation or not?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. So the next factor that they thought of was, they said ki only mass cannot be the criteria. Fine. So because they had seen the effects of a bullet. A bullet is so tiny, a bullet is so small, but it causes a lot of damage. So then the other factor came into picture. They said ki bullet travels with lot of with a very high speed. Fine. So they said ki along, yes, mass plays a role, but velocity of the object also plays a role. Because a bullet which is so tiny can cause lot of damage. It comes with such high velocity that it can pierce the body of a person. It can pierce a sandbag. It can pierce a wall. It can go through a glass. So they thought ki, so these two factors were considered main when they were considering effects of forces. One was mass and one was velocity. One alone could not explain the amount of force acting on the object. And then they argued that the time for which the change is taking place also affects. Fine. So you are applying force on an object. For how long you are applying? So based upon all these observations, Newton gave us the second law of motion. Okay. And to give the second law of motion, they define a quantity called as momentum. So momentum, in simple terms, is only a physical quantity, which is a vector quantity. Its formula is mass into velocity. So if I want to calculate the momentum of an object, momentum of an object is the product of the mass and velocity of the object. Why was the need felt for this quantity? The need was felt because it was argued that mass and velocity both somehow contribute towards how much force is acting on the body. Okay. And what will be the units of momentum? Units of momentum would be unit of mass, that is kilogram, multiplied by units of velocity, that is meter per second. Fine. So I get kg meter per second as the unit of momentum. Okay. Now momentum is a very important quantity. Please keep it in mind. Using this quantity, Newton gave the second law of motion. He said that the rate of change of momentum of an object is proportional to the applied force in the direction of force. So what does this statement mean? This statement means, look at it this way. So suppose this ball was here. It was having some velocity u. Okay, you come and kick it and its velocity becomes v. Fine. Now this change in which its velocity went from u to v occurred in time t. So what was the initial momentum of the ball? Initial momentum of ball would be
zero.
Mass. Momentum is mass into velocity. So this time it would be mass into initial velocity. I never said that the ball is at rest. I said it had some initial velocity u. So that would, the initial momentum is m into u. And after kicking, the final momentum becomes, please tell me what would be the final momentum?
Mass into final velocity.
Very good. So it would be m into v. So its momentum has changed. The momentum of the ball has changed. So what is the change in momentum? Change in momentum is mv minus mu. Okay. So Newton said that the force acting on the ball, if I want to measure the force acting on the ball, I will see the rate of change of momentum, meaning how fast or slow this momentum change took place. So if this is change in momentum, rate of change in momentum would be mv minus mu divided by t. Whenever we are talking about rate of change of a quantity, we divide that quantity by a factor of time. So he said that rate of change in momentum is equal to the applied force on the object. And he also gave the direction of force. He said that the direction of force would be in the direction of change in momentum. So here, where is the final velocity? Final velocity is somewhere here. So this force will act in the direction of the change in momentum. So whichever way the change is taking place, force will act along that direction. I hope first law, second law of motion is much more clearer to you now.
Yes.
So in generic terms, he said that the force acting on an object is proportional to the rate of change in momentum. So this quantity mv minus u, mu is your change in momentum.
Ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, it is directly proportional.
Yes, it is directly proportional to rate of change in momentum. It is not directly proportional to time. But it is directly proportional to rate of change in momentum.
Okay, ma'am.
So I write F is proportional to change in momentum divided by time taken. The same thing in symbolic form, I can write F is proportional to MV minus MU divided by T. Now, proportionality means that it is dependent. Now, I can say that, say, Avantika, I will give you twice the mark Stuti gets. Suppose I say. So, in that case, Avantika's marks are proportional to Stuti's mark. Fine. Now, I said, proportional means they are dependent upon Stuti's marks. But if I remove the proportionality sign, I introduce a constant. In that, I have to tell how much more or how much less. So I just said, I will give you twice the marks of Stuti's marks. So Avantika's marks in this case become, so till the time I'm saying that Avantika's marks are dependent upon Stuti's marks, I'm using the proportionality sign. When I say that Avantika's marks are twice Stuti's marks, then I have removed the proportionality sign. I have introduced the constant 2. Now this is totally my choice. I could have given Avantika half of Stuti's marks. So in that case, constant would have been half. Okay, so similarly, here this proportionality sign shows that force is dependent upon rate of change in momentum. But we don't know how much. So when we remove the proportionality sign, we introduce a constant. So I've removed the proportionality sign. I'm introducing equal to. So I write K times M. Let's take M common, so V minus U by T. Now this is some familiar quantity, V minus U by T. What is this quantity?
Acceleration.
This is acceleration. So V minus U by T is nothing but our acceleration. So I get force is equal to K times mass into acceleration. Now as per SI unit, it has been found using experimental techniques that K comes out to be 1. So I get my second law of motion as force equals to mass into acceleration. Got it? So if you're not able to remember the whole statement and you are asked about second law of motion, the least you can do is at least write down that force is equal to mass into acceleration. Ye aapko hamesha yaad rakhna motion. So what has second law given me? Second law has given me a way to measure force. How much force? So I just told you that second law also contains first law. Do you want to see how?
Yes, ma'am.
So if we want to see that second law contains first law, let's see what does first law says. First law says that unless a force acts on an object, if it was at rest, it will remain at rest. If it was in motion, it will remain in motion. Uniform motion. Okay. So let's see. So let's make force equals to zero. Let's say that there is no force acting on the object. This means mass into acceleration equals to zero. Acceleration is V minus U by T. Now, mass of an object can never be zero. We already know that. It's a universal truth that if an object, every matter will occupy space and it will have some mass associated with it. So mass can never be zero. It means this quantity V minus U by T equals to zero. Ab V minus U by T kab zero hogi? Ya to T infinite ho jaye. Ya to denominator infinite ho jaye. Ya fir V equals to U ho jaye. V minus U by T quantity kab zero hogi? Ya to T bahut 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 bada hai, which is like again an impractical case. Ya fir, so T cannot be infinity. So that leaves us with only one option, that V equals to U. So V equals to U means if object was at rest initially, so if U was zero, V equals to zero. That means object stays at rest. It was at rest and it stays at rest when no force is acting. Or U equal to V means if the object was moving with some velocity, it will continue to move with the same velocity. So this is a case of uniform motion. And this is our first law of motion, that if there is no force acting on the object, object will either stay at rest or it will continue in its state of uniform motion. So I can use my second law to explain the first law of motion. Now from this definition, we can also look at the units of force. Yes.
Ma'am.
I'll send the slides. Okay. So let's look at the units of force. We know from right now we studied force is mass into acceleration. So what will be the SI unit of force? SI unit of force would be
Newton.
Unit of mass multiplied by unit of acceleration, which is meter per second square. So the unit of force is basically kg meter per second square. So just to simplify things, we have given it a name, Newton. The symbol is N. Okay, the symbol is capital N. And see, if you have to write 10 Newton of force, please never write 10 Newtons. We never use plurals with units. 10 Newton already means you are giving the magnitude. So there is never use plural in units. And don't put full stop after units.
Ma'am.
Hanji.
Ma'am, our next meeting is started.
But the period is still 10 o'clock.
The period is still at 10 o'clock. I also saw. Okay? The period is still 10 o'clock. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now just to simplify things over, kg meter per second square has been assigned the name called as Newton, because this is like one of the most important units which we will be using very often. So it makes more sense to use a single unit just for convenience. Okay? And if I have to define one Newton, try and define one Newton and also try and experience one Newton. How much force do you think one Newton is? So one Newton would be the force which can produce, look at that, whenever you have to define units, look at the formula. Then it is the force which will produce an acceleration of 1 m/s² in a body of mass 1 kg. A force which, when applied to a body of mass 1 kg, produces an acceleration of 1 m/s² is called 1 N. Okay, so how much is 1 N? It is that amount of force which will produce an acceleration of 1 m/s² in a body of mass 1 kg. Got it? So now we come on to some real life examples of Newton's second law of motion. But because only 4 minutes are left, I don't think it makes much of a sense. So I'll just give you a brief idea. Whenever you want to control the amount of force, you can control it using these factors. What all factors you see here? The time for which the force acts and the amount of momentum change. That will decide how much force is acting on the object. So to reduce the force, what should you do? Increase the time of momentum change or decrease the time of momentum change? To reduce force, we should increase the time or decrease the time of momentum change? Tell me. Think about it.
Increase the time.
Very good. We should increase the time. ठीक है, क्योंकि टाइम इंक्रीज करने से क्या होगा, डिनोमिनेटर बड़ा होगा, और जैसे ही डिनोमिनेटर बड़ा होगा तो ओवरऑल क्वांटिटी डिक्रीज होगी. ठीक है, एंड दैट प्रिंसिपल इज यूज्ड इन योर हाई जंप, लॉन्ग जंप. क्वेश्चंस होते हैं ना हाई जंप में?
यस मैम.
और लॉन्ग जंप में सैंड बेड्स होते हैं फॉर एथलीट टू फॉल अपॉन, है ना? सो ऑल दीज आर practical applications of second law of motion. We will discuss them in our next class. Okay.